boys and girls, students of Buddhist Sunday School, parents, grandparents, teachers of Sunday School and moral education. May you all be well and peaceful. We are going to tell you another Jataka story that has a good moral lesson. The story is titled Caution Pace. Caution means carefulness, right? Heedfulness. Being cautious means to be careful, right? Caution. Cautious, caution. Now we're going to show you the PowerPoint and I will read the story and explain the story. And then at the end, we'll summarize the moral lessons or the Dharma messages, right? So let us launch the PowerPoint. Now you see the first slide, and here you can see certain pictures, animated things also. Now let us have a look at the pictures. Now let me stop the video showing me lah. Now, as I said just now, the story is titled Caution Pace. Caution means being careful, being cautious is an important thing. And in the end, it can actually bring you benefits or even save your life or, you know, bring something that is good. So being cautious is a very good thing. The opposite is being careless, being mindless, heedless. So to have caution, to be cautious is an important thing. We say it pays, right? It brings benefits. Now you can see here, this is the antelope. The antelope is of the same family as the deer, right? It's quite similar. The horns can go continuously, the antelope. Right? It's a mammal, can run very, very fast, right? So you can say it's a sister group to the deer, right? Here you have another picture of the antelope, a very prominent horns that keep growing, you know, as the antelope grows older and older. This actually is the hunter, right? So let us look at the story. I think there's one more cover slide. Here you see, this is also the picture of an antelope, as I say, of the same family as the deer. Of course, these are the butterflies, and these are the birds, right? So I think you can understand very easily. Now, in a forest near Varanasi, there lived an antelope, which was very fond of the fruits of a particular tree. Now, this place in India, Varanasi, was very, very old. It's one of the oldest cities of the world. The old name was Benares. And near this Varanasi, you have the place called Sarnath, where the Buddha preached the first sermon, right? At Sarnath, he preached the formable truths, actually. And if you go to Varanasi, you can actually see the river Ganges, Mother River, you know, very important for India. And you can take a cruise along the river Ganges. That is this Varanasi. So there was this forest, and in the forest lived an antelope. That is this antelope. It was very fond of the fruits of a particular tree. It liked to eat the fruits of that particular tree. What is the blackbird? Now, the antelope led a carefree life, no stress, right? And full of joy, maybe. He enjoys his life. Carefree means to be free from trouble and care. Today, many people are stressed and full of trouble, a worry, a problem. But this antelope, carefree, right? No problems, right? No stress. However, he was always cautious and mindful. He had these two good qualities. being careful, being cautious, and being mindful to know what is happening around him all the time. So these are two very important qualities for a person, right, to develop, to be very cautious and to be mindful. Now, in a village nearby lived a hunter who knew this. He knew about the antelope liking the fruits of a particular tree. Know what he said? This hunter said, I must get him today. So you see, the hunter was out to trap the poor antelope, you know. So early that morning, what did the hunter do? The hunter went to the jungle to go to the tree because he knew the antelope would come to that tree to take or eat the fruits. So he was going to trap the antelope, kill the antelope, and then sell the meat. That's what he said, you see? He's a big animal. I will get quite some money by selling his meat. So you see, he is earning a living in this manner, which is not good. After we talk about that, the wrong type of livelihood to sell the meat of this antelope. So this cartoon shows very sad because the hunter was going to kill the antelope. So let us look at the next one. So what did the hunter do to catch the antelope? He built a platform on the tree. So you see, you know, this platform built on the tree where he could go on top and then look out for the animal coming, and then he would trap it and kill it. And this sort of platform, those days, they use for trying to look up for the animals and then to trap it. It's called the machan, the platform. But nowadays, many use this machan for watching the wild animals, maybe, or the animals in the forest, you know. You go to the tree, go on top of the machan, and then quietly, you observe the animals coming, you don't make noise. So that is this machan. So he put up a machan on the tree here, the platform, and waited for the antelope. This monkey didn't like what he saw because this hunter was going to kill the antelope. The monkey didn't like that. He didn't want to see this sort of killing. And he was thinking, he should be here any moment now. And let us see what happens. As usual, the antelope came strolling along in a very carefree manner. So happy, walking, strolling along, no problem, no stress. So he was thinking, just thinking of that fruit makes me hungry. The fruit from that particular tree. But he was a clever antelope and never missed a thing. Just now remember, I told you the antelope had these two very good qualities. One is to be always cautious and careful. And the second thing, to be mindful, to be aware of what is in the surroundings. So he was very mindful, observant, and he noticed, hey, a man's footprints. So he knew already there was a hunter around, probably to trap him and kill him. So you see how important mindfulness is, caution is. So the antelope, as we said just now, was very observant and mindful indeed. That could save his life, you know. So today, many people are not mindful, they are careless, they have accidents, they fall down, right? They make mistakes because not mindful, not observant, not cautious. So you can learn from this Dhatakasa story. So he was actually thinking, there must be a hunter nearby waiting to kill me. Very smart animal, isn't it? So this hunter, on top of the platform of the machan, right, was getting impatient. So he was thinking, why doesn't he come near? I shall try throwing some fruit to him. Maybe that will lure him to the tree. Actually his plan was to wait for the antelope to be sufficiently near the tree, and then he would use his spear, all right? And he would throw the spear and kill the antelope, or pierce through the body of the antelope, you know? But the antelope was very smart. He did not go too near the tree, you see? So then this hunter was wondering, why is this so? Maybe if I throw the favorite fruits, his favorite fruits, then this will lure. Lure means to like attract and bring the person near, right? To tempt him and then to attract the person to come near the place that is luring. So that's what he thought. As you see here, the hunter was getting impatient already to kill the antelope. This monkey was worried. He did not dare to see. Right. What will happen, you know, poor antelope are in great danger. Monkey also his friend. As I said just now, right, the antelope was most cautious. He noticed the corner of the platform or the machan. You can see here, you see, a platform was built on top of the tree, right, the branches supporting the platform, but he could see the corner. You know? The other parts probably were hidden by the leaves of the tree. You know? But he could see this and he knew already that there was this hunter waiting there to kill him. And you see, very, very observant. And he could think carefully. Oh, there's someone up the tree. The fruit is being thrown to me. It isn't dropping as it usually does. So, you know, you could think, usually the fruits will drop, especially when they are ripe, isn't it? But this time, it's being thrown. Somebody must be throwing. So he was very careful, really. He knew, really, it was a trap, right? So he did not go near already, right? Otherwise, he would go near the tree to get more of the fruits. As I told you just now, he saw the corner of the machan. He said, yes, now I am sure I can see the corner of a machan. So his suspicion was confirmed. There was a man, a hunter, top of the tree on the platform of machan waiting to kill him. So he was very careful. He did not go near. So this antelope was an intelligent animal, right? He knew he had to check out any danger, right? Otherwise, he could be killed easily. So then he thought of a plan. I'll pretend to talk to the tree and see what happens, right? He said, he didn't go near. So then he shouted, listen, tree, you have always dropped your fruit on the earth. Why do you throw it at me today? He wanted to confirm, to test that actually there was this man up there, hidden in the leaves, among the leaves. Listen, tree, you have always dropped your fruit on the earth. Why do you throw at me this time? You throw the fruit at me this time, today. To see what the answer would be. So, of course, the man heard him, right? Of course, in the Jataka story, the animals could talk, right? It's a story, tale. So, then he waited. He didn't go near, right? Because if he had gone too near, the spear would come and pierce him, right? What, sir? He thinks he's smart, does he? So, what did the antelope do next? He shouted, "And so, tree, since you have stopped behaving like a normal tree, I too will behave differently. I shall eat elsewhere." So what did he say? He say, you used to talk. Now you have stopped behaving like a normal tree, throwing the fruits. So I too will behave in a different way. I will go elsewhere and eat the fruits, not this tree. So the smart antelope was not taking any risk. He did not do anything carelessly. That'd be very dangerous, isn't it? So of course the hunter was getting a bit worried, scared already that he could not get at the antelope, killing him by killing him, because the antelope would be going away. So what did the hunter do? He didn't say anything, but he knew he had lost his chance, and he threw his javelin. This is like a javelin, actually the spear. It's a spear or a javelin, very pointed end, made of metal. If you pierce you, you would die. You could be hurt. So the hunter knew that he had lost his chance, and he threw his javelin. But because the antelope was a bit further away, so it was not easy for the javelin to have that impactful penetration of force on the body. So it missed, actually. Whoosh! Actually, there was this version that the hunter quickly came down the tree and started to chase the antelope. But antelope can run very, very fast. So no way the hunter could catch up with him. As now the cover story, you could see that the hunter was chasing. But in this particular version, he did not say whether he came down to chase him. He just threw the spear, but he was not near enough for him to hit. So the antelope ran away and said, "Hee hee, too bad, hunter. Better luck next time." And he ran away very fast. So you see, because of his mindfulness, his caution, his heedfulness, his care, he could save his life because he was always alert. So we see, by his smart and cautious attitude, the antelope was able to escape from the hunter, to escape from being killed, isn't it? So there's a very, very simple Jataka story, but we are going to learn some important moral lessons and also some Dharma, right? So I hope you understand this. So let us now go on to the we are going to learn at the last slide four important points, right? And also Dharma incorporated inside. Animation, you could see the flock of birds, and you could see this antelope. It could be a deer, sometimes quite difficult to distinguish. This probably is antelope, right? And you have this deer or antelope grazing on the meadow to eat the grass. So let us look at the lessons. The first one, very careful. Right? Be careful, heedful, and cautious. So careful, you know what is careful, right? Mesti cermat. Very, very careful in whatever you do. Some people are very careless, even doing their work, their assignments, their projects. Make a lot of mistakes because they are not careful. Heedful also has this point of being very cautious and being heedful to know, right? What are the dangers? To know what is happening around you, right? That's being heedful. And also when you are heedful, you probably will follow very wise advice, right? People ask you to heed certain wise advice. That means to follow. then you will not get into danger or trouble. And cautious, I think you know, is the adjective, and the noun is caution, right? To be very, very careful or cautious. When you cross the road, you have to be cautious and careful, right? Otherwise, you can be knocked down by the vehicles. When you cross the road, you have to look left and right and left again, and then you have to look more times nowadays because there are crazy people that will just speed by. Even at traffic lights, they will dash across the traffic lights where the traffic lights show red. You know, I've experienced this. So you have to be very careful. So that's the first important point you have to learn. Now let's look at the second one. Practice mindfulness. You know, in Dharma lessons, we always emphasize on mindfulness. Mindfulness, here in this case here, you can take it to mean to be attentive, to be alert in the mind, to be aware, to know what is happening around you, to know even what is in your mind state, right? If your mind is wandering, thinking of all the nonsense thing, and you're not paying attention to the immediate surrounding or the immediate happening, can be dangerous, isn't it? So you have to be mindful also of the mind. So whatever you're doing, you have to pay attention to the thing, right? And also be aware to know. Be aware means to also to know what are the things that happen around you. Right? So mindfulness is a very important thing to practice in Dharma. So when the person is mindful, usually his memory is good, right? He can remember things very well. So imagine if you have very good mindfulness, your studies will be very good. You can remember things well. You will score in the examination. You are less forgetful. You make very few mistakes. So that is mindfulness. Now we come to this point of hunting. Hunting is an unwholesome. Unwholesome means unskillful or not good. Right? So you see, hunting, you are harming other living beings. In this case, for example, the animals. Right? People go to hunt for wild boars, monkeys, deer, all sorts of things. And then, like this case, now you saw, he said that he would kill the antelope and then after that sell the meat. So probably, you know, he wanted to get money. So in Buddhism, we say that killing an animal, right? And then to sell the flesh and so on, that is not right livelihood. And then some people, you know, they go hunting because they think it's a very exciting sport. They call it. But do you ever think, if you were hunted, you'll be very scared, isn't it? And then if the poor, let's say mother monkey, right, and then gets killed about the children, isn't it? So it's a very terrible type of hobby. To hunt the animals, you know, they are so scared, you know, isn't it? So don't take up this sort of hobby. And next time, don't make hunting a livelihood to earn your living by hunting. In fact, in Buddhism, there are certain types of jobs. Later on, when you grow up, then you know that these sort of jobs are not right type of jobs, are not right livelihood. Mata pencarian. So you should not get this, you should not be involved in this type of work to earn money. One is trading in flesh. That means to rear animals or to hunt animals, and then to sell animals after you kill them. Not involved killing, right? So that is not a good type of a job. And then also involving in trading of human beings. People nowadays, they go and kidnap the women or the children and then sell them, do the rotten things. Trading in flesh, trading in human beings, that also is a terrible thing. And then trading business involving weaponry, that means weapons Oh, there are people go for, you know, business that involve making of weapons, guns, bombs, and all sorts of weaponry that can involve in, that can be used to harm people, right? In battles and so on. So getting involved in this type of business is not a good livelihood, right? And then you have also, one more is some people are involved in business making the chemicals, the terrible chemicals that are used to poison animals in the farm or to kill off certain smaller animals. Or now they even, you know, manufacture the drugs also should come under this category. Because when you manufacture the drugs and people take the drugs, they get hurt, isn't it? Some can be killed also, overdose. So involved in this sort of business is wrong livelihood, right? To make chemicals that can bring harm or killing to people or kill off people. That's the fourth one. And the fifth one is, just now I'm talking about the drug, they should come into the fifth one. That means not to be involved in a trade where you sell the alcohol, minuman arak. After taking it, you get drunk. So just now the one, the drugs one should come under the fifth one, not the fourth one. The fourth one will be more poisons where they use in agriculture to kill off the pests. So now people go for another type of farming, organic farming, you know, very, very good type of farming where you don't kill the various animals. You have a, you know, harmonious living. But now people use lots of pesticides, you know, right? And then when you buy the fruits and the vegetables, the remnants of the chemicals still remain on the vegetables and fruits. And when you eat them, you get all the terrible dangers, right? The bad effects from the pesticide. No wonder nowadays you have also a lot of sicknesses, right? Diseases due to the pesticides accumulating in the foodstuff that we eat from the farms and so on. So these are the various types of jobs not considered wholesome, or we consider that wrong livelihood, right? So because now you are students, so you are maybe not working yet, but this to know so that you learn it, so next time you won't get involved in this, even though you get more money, but you are not practicing right livelihood, right? So now we go on to the fourth one. This is think before you act, become. Many people don't think. They act first, then after that they regret, isn't it? So somehow, you know, they do silly things. I remember many, many years ago when we brought some students to Penang, you know, along Gurney Drive, you know, right? So there was this boy, now of course today, I don't name him, today he is, you know, a father of many children already. So the time he was probably in Form 2 or something like that. So we went on an excursion. And he had a good heart, but he sometimes acts without thinking. So we were walking along the Gurney Drive Road, and then I think one of the students' shoes, fell down, you know. You know, there was, you know, a small wall like that. And then, you know, you go down, then you have the beach, right? So, you know what he did? Without thinking, he jumped down, you know. He could actually break his leg, you know. He jumped down to try to go and retrieve the shoe, you know. So, he never thought before he acted. It could be very dangerous, isn't it? So, I've seen so many cases where people don't think before they act. And because of this, they can bring harm to themselves and also to others. So get the habit of thinking wisely before you act. And just like this antelope, right? Before just going near the tree, he was very, very careful. And he looked around and saw the footprints in it. Already he knew already, oh, I must not go near, right? So he was careful. So he think before he acted. That will be good. This one requires you to have a mind that is quite sturdy and quite calm, especially when certain dangerous things happen and your mind karang kabut, you know, right? You could not think clearly really. Why? Because your mind was not sturdy and calm. If you have a calm and sturdy mind, then even though things outside can be quite challenging, yet you can think. And for this, you need to practice the mind training. Right? That's why, you know, in Sunday school, you start off with a puja and then a short practice of meditation. Right? So meditation, sitting still, right? Just observing your breath or doing metta bhavana is a good way to train your mind to be more powerful, to be strong, to be sturdy, and to be calm, more calm. Right? Then you can think better, more wisely. So these are the 4 points I would like to discuss, and hope that you can remember these 4 points, and you can also share with your friends. You can introduce them to the presentation. All these are found in the YouTube, right? And it is a good thing to introduce this Dhamma moral lessons to friends. So before we conclude, I would like to express my thanks to all the students who take time to listen to this discussion, this presentation, to watch this presentation, and also to parents, grandparents, and teachers for taking time to go over this presentation. And we hope collectively all of us can help to spread the Dhamma in one way or other. So we conclude by saying sadhu 3 times. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. May you all be well and peaceful. Take care.